Okay. Here, angiosperms. Angiosperms are defined by their ability to make flowers and fruits. So here's an example. This is a trap lily or dogtooth lily. I often teach this class in the spring, and so I like to give a spring flower as an example. Maybe you saw some of these in spring if you go hiking. They were here in Rhode Island. I saw some in April. They're very pretty. And you can see, got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different petals, and so this is a monocot. It might also be given away by the fact that they're called lilies. All the lilies are in the monocot family. It's got some nice little anthers hanging down here, and you can see there is the carpel with the ovary, the style, and the stigma. Okay, so it has all the true parts of a flower. Instead of having ovulate cones and male cones, we now have put the sexual parts inside of a special organ called a flower that not only protects the different parts but also attracts pollinators. So now most of the gymnosperms use just wind to get their pollen around, which is why they make such copious amounts of pollen, which you know if you've ever parked your car underneath an eastern white pine, and instead you can make less pollen now if you're an angiosperm, because you're going to have a pollinator take your pollen directly from you to your mate someplace else. So angiosperms are very similar to gymnosperms in their life cycle, but instead of having naked seeds, they're going to have ovaries, and also the nutritive tissue inside of the seeds is going to come from a double fertilization event. So here's your flower. The flower has anthers, and inside of those anthers is where you're going to form the microspore, which is also called a pollen grain, and once it's divided, that's considered a male gametophyte, and that's the stage at which it gets taken by a pollinator over to a female flower. Inside of the female flower, you have an ovary protecting all of the little ovules inside. The ovule undergoes meiosis to form the megaspore. The megaspore grows to make several different nuclei. Some of those nuclei are going to be the polar bodies, and one of those nucleuses is going to be the egg. The egg gets pollinated by the sperm by growing down in a pollen tube down to where the egg is. One sperm will become the baby daddy, and the other one is going to contribute its genetic material to the endosperm. So we now have a zygote that is 2N, and we have the endosperm, which is triploid tissue there. Here's the baby plant with its lunch inside of a lunchbox, but this is a lunchbox that also has a second part of tissue outside of it, which is often there to either protect the little plant inside, to get it dispersed around by clinging on to different animal furs and that sort of thing, or maybe even offer a treat to an animal in order to induce it to carry those seeds away from mom to someplace else. Once that seed is set down and loses dormancy, it can germinate and grow into another sporophyte individual. Okay, so when we get up to the flowering plants, we still see all of these traits that we saw earlier. This is a vascular plant, so it can become woody. It can be very large, right? It has a cuticle covering. It also makes seeds like gymnosperms, but this has a further adaptation in that it makes flowers and fruits. Two ways in order that it can move its genetic material around. By making flowers, it gets its pollen to move around, its male gametes to be moved around by helpers, and by making a fruit, it can get its seeds to be moved around, again, by animal helpers. Within the angiosperms, there's a lot of diversity. We have been talking a lot about the difference between dicots and monocots. Here is a phylogeny in which we've colored everything that has two seed leaves orange, and things that have a one seed leaf red. And you can see that the monocots are all a single lineage buried within the angiosperms. There are these plants down here that have more primitive characteristics of the angiosperms, and these used to be called dicots. But now, when we talk about the dicots, what we usually want to talk about is a lineage that has a single common ancestor separate from everyone else. And so we like to call this new separate group the eudicots, or the good dicots, a group of dicots that make a single historical lineage together. These other primitive dicots have been given separate names according to their lineage. The biggest group of lineages here are the Magnolias down here. So let's take a look at what some of these look like. The most primitive angiosperm that we found that's still growing is called Amborella. Again, this is one that we only find in Australia. And this is what its flowers look like. It makes male flowers and female flowers. You can see that the male flowers just look like naked little anthers sticking out, and the female flowers are not very pretty. They're pretty much just naked carpels. They are very primitive as far as their floral characteristics and their look. The other basal kind of groups of the angiosperms are the nymphaceae, or water lilies, and the magnolias. Okay. In both of these cases, you can see that they now look more like flowers, but these flowers have multiple parts and are more of a spiral kind of pattern to them, rather than the simple four-layered bullseye that we learned flowers look like. So these guys have kind of more multiple parts, uncertain numbers of parts. They don't necessarily always have the same number of petals, and instead the petals are formed in a kind of a spiral pattern coming inwards. But again, you have kind of sepal petal kind of things to the outside. You then have stamens and interior carpels. Here, all the stamens have fallen off. Well, there's a few still here. And then you can see the carpels up at the top with these kind of curly stigmas coming out of them. Within the magnoliids, the two major lineages are monocots and the eudicots. Here's examples of monocots here. This is a palm tree, this is a banana tree, and this here is rice. And then within the eudicots, we have cacti and flower plants and buttercups and you name it, all sorts of different flowers. Again, 99% of the things that you see when you look outside are angiosperms. Pretty much every plant that you can name off the top of your head are going to fall in this either monocot or dicot group. So again, just to remind you of how you can tell eudicots and monocots apart, two little cotyledons inside of the seeds for the eudicots, one inside of the monocots, floral parts in four or five versus floral parts in multiples of three, net-like veins when you look at the leaves. Their pollen grains actually look different. You actually get little three furrows in the eudicots, whereas usually there's only a single pore in the monocot pollen, if you took a close look at it. And then lastly, the way that their vascular tissue is bundled in the stems and also in the roots is slightly different. In the stems, you'll remember that there's a central pith to your eudicots with these vascular bundles in a single ring around them, whereas with the monocots, you get multiple vascular bundles spread throughout the stem. Let's talk about some major families that fall in these different groups. The largest plant family on Earth is the Orchidaceae, which might seem a little strange to those of us in North America because most of these are tropical. There are quite a few orchids that do occur here in North America. If you're from Rhode Island, I think there's only two or three different small orchids that are naturally found here. The one that you might know the best is the Lady's Slipper, which is fairly large. So it's the largest family of flowering plants. They have 800 or more genera, and there are 20,000 plus species that fall into this group. Many of them are epiphytes, and what this means is that they don't grow on soil, but actually grow on other plants. If you go to the tropics, you'll often see inside of trees and that sort of thing, other plants that are growing off of the limbs of the tree or along the trunk of the tree, and that's an epiphyte. Instead of having their roots in the soil, their roots either run along the surface or down into the bark of the tree. Sometimes this is a detriment to the tree, but a lot of the times they're commensals, and what that means is that they don't negatively affect the fitness of the tree that they're living on. They get their water from water falling in rain and coming down the tree, and they get their other nutrients from different bits and pieces of things that litter out down from the top of the canopy of the of the forest and get caught in amongst their roots or in amongst their leaves. And as they rot and break down, those nutrients become available to the epiphyte living on the tree. These guys are probably have so many species because they have very interesting pollination syndromes. They have these elaborate pollination adaptations. For one thing, they put all of their pollen into one little package called a polonia, or a little, it's like a little purse that has all of their pollen in one little package. So they have to make sure that they get pollinated by having at least one pollinator come and take their pollen away.